thinking about Rimmel, again, the goal of Rimmel is to think about, you've got bias that is being induced by the estimation of the mean model parameters, beta, and then those things, if you think about them in usually what we would call a profile likelihood, which means I would just take my estimate for beta and I would plug it in and I would solve for the MLE for sigma in that case. That's going to induce bias in the estimate of sigma because it would not account for the fact that you estimate beta. It's a very, very kind of intuitive principle here. Right? And there's uncertainty that's going on inside of beta, those mean model parameters, and so we need to take care of that. And again, this is very, very familiar to you. In the one sample problem for normally distributed data where you divided by n minus 1 for your variance estimate, you were doing that because you didn't know mu. You had to estimate mu with x bar. You lost a degree of freedom effectively. That induced bias. That induced bias is really the fact that you had uncertainty in you. Okay? So in other words, you had to tie your data back in to do that estimate. So it's the same principle here. Again, you saw it again in linear regression, you divided by n minus p. Now we just have multiple variance components going on. So that gives rise to this concept of regression. Okay, so what we were doing then was we were saying, okay, well, maybe we can decompose the likelihood for beta and sigma into a product, basically, of two likelihoods. So in other words, a marginal likelihood for sigma that does not depend upon beta, and then another component, another factor that it will be a function of beta. And then if you can do that, then inference for sigma estimation can be just based upon the marginal portion that doesn't involve beta anymore, so you don't have to worry about the fact you have estimate. Okay? That's the underlying principle here. So what we're doing is heading that direction. We're thinking about, well, okay, let's take my response. I'll take some linear transformation of that response. I'm going to take it to some u and some beta hat g, where again, u comes from thinking about a contrast matrix. And this b we know exists. We talked about the reasons for that last time, so you guys know why. It's basically coming from the spectral decomposition theorem. And then the other transformation we're going to think about is just your good old generalized least squares estimator. So in other words, the weighted least squares estimator where I put in the inverse of the true variance covariance matrix is coming through. Okay. So now that I've got this transformation, again, one of the things we have to do to write down the PDF for that transformation is the Jacobian. We did that last time. It came to a pretty nice form. But we also want to think a little bit about the covariance now between the two elements of that transformation. So that's where we're going here. So just first principles, if we think about the covariance here, it's going to take this form. And the reason why I'm writing it this way, well, okay, so this is the expectation of beta hat g. The expectation of u is zero, right? Because the expectation of this beta transpose y is a contrast matrix. So it has mean zero there. That's how we came up with it. And so now, once I take this guy, plug in exactly what everything is, well, what is u? That's beta transpose times y. And then my beta hat g, once I bring this transpose through, I'm going to write it as y transpose times g. Or again, g is what we define from the generalized least squares estimator. Oops.
Yeah, that's true.
I want that offer there. Sorry. Dot there. It's just the multiplier there. Okay. well, that's a constant, I'll bring the expectation in. That's like the expectation on y squared, so I can rewrite that guy. So if I pop out the b, then what I will have inside, I can rewrite, is just the variance now of y plus the expectation of y times the expectation of y transpose times g on the other side. So again, think about that as like y squared in the scalar case. I can write it as the variance of y plus the expectation of y squared. And then over here, I'm going to get a b transpose. Well, when I take the expectation of y inside of here, I get an x times beta, and then I get a beta transpose. Well, that's kind of nice because, what do we know about that? From what we did last time? For those of you that were here. That guy is zero from being a contrast matrix. And so now, what I have left over is B transpose, let's call this thing sigma times B plus B transpose X beta. And then I'll get an X beta transpose sitting there. Oh, that's kind of nice again because beta transpose x is there. That thing is equal to zero. So that's good. I wanted a g on there too, but it's going to all go to zero anyways because I got that zero leading off the front. And so now, when I look at this though, let's take what g actually is. So I got a b transpose a sigma. Well, what is G? When I think about it, it's going to be the transpose of this guy up here. So I'm going to get a sigma inverse. And then I'm going to get an X. And then I'm going to get an X transpose sigma inverse X inverse. So that guy is going to cancel with that guy. One of those is multivariate normal, right? Because they're just linear combinations of something that I started off with is multivariate normal. And so they're multivariate normal. The covariance is equal to zero. So I know that u and beta hat g are independent. Okay. That's right. interdependent, though, and we also know that U does not depend upon beta at all. We wrote that down right at the very beginning when we wrote down U. So this guy then just looks like F U alpha. Over here I've got F beta hat G. And then I've got an alpha here, a beta here, and a Jacobian. Ooh, that's kind of nice for us. If you think about what I have written in the notes where I talk about kind of the general theory of the marginal likelihood, you can think about this as saying, ah, okay, that's S1 in my notes, and that's lambda, okay? And so this thing here, marginal likelihood that we would be interested in. In other words, it depends upon our alphas, the things that we want to estimate right now. It does not depend upon beta at all. Okay. So again, what I used in my notes was just a generic version where you had sufficient statistics, S1 lambda, S2 phi. All right. So now, want to solve for that guy, so let's rearrange. Doesn't matter what FU alpha is. That's just FY alpha beta divided by F beta hat G alpha beta times the Jacobian inverse but we know each of these guys so we know that FY alpha beta is equal to 2 pi minus n over 2, determinant of sigma to the minus 1 half times e raised to the minus 1 half y minus x beta sigma inverse y minus x beta transpose. Multivariate normal, variance, covariance, alpha, mean, x, beta. Again, sigma here, variance, covariance, sigma, sorry, which depends upon alpha. I'm being a little bit of myself. Sigma is implicitly dependent upon alpha. We also know something about beta hat g in this case. That guy is also going to be multivariate normal. It's 2 pi to the minus p upon 2. Well, what's the covariance covariance matrix of beta hat g? Sigma in there. There's a transpose. So I think it's going to be x transpose sigma inverse x inverse.
Yeah.
Right? So it is just a generalized least squares estimator. You can cancel out on that path. So we normally keep the minus one. Finally, beta hat G minus beta transpose. Okay, so we know what both of those guys look like. Last time we also again solved for the Jacobian over here. So we're pretty well done. So if I want to know the density for Fu alpha, that guy then is going to be equal to, I'm just going to write it as some C. The Jacobian that we came up with last time was X transpose X, the determinant of that guy. Hit it to the 1/2 now. Was that the minus 1? Or minus 1/2? Sigma to the minus 1/2. All over X transpose sigma X determinant to 1/2. EXP now. EXP to the minus 1/2. You're going to get some cancellation that's going to occur. You're going to get Y minus X beta hat G transpose sigma inverse Y minus X beta hat G. Like so. And I just noticed something actually. Marginal likelihood, or at least the PDF is going to give rise to the marginal likelihood, so now we'll think about the loss likelihood that were students from that. Oh yeah. C, of course, is just going to be 2 pi to the, once you do the arithmetic, it'll be minus capital N minus P divided by 2, once you kind of combine everything. The key thing here is if you compare this, to the profile log likelihood, again, that would be the log likelihood that we would have arrived at if we had just stuck beta hat g into the original PDF, in other words, not gone through the trouble of deriving the marginal likelihood. That as a little p alpha. So that's going to be a minus.
to have G transpose sigma to the alpha minus 1 y minus x beta hat g. And so that's what you would have gotten had you just kind of walked through and said, forget about the marginal likelihood. And you can see the obvious difference here is that term that's sitting there. That term is what's accounting for the bias and happening to the estimated beta. Restricted maximum likelihood, again, you're doing good old MLE like you normally would profile likelihood on beta, but then when you come back through with an estimate for beta, namely beta hat g, you're plugging that guy into this guy here and solving the derivative of that log likelihood equal to zero. As I noted before, midterm Wednesday, everything up through the end of the last lecture, okay, which counts everything that I derived up to the point where I began today.
And that's everything he derived will be on the exam, not his possible.
I didn't exactly say that, Kyle. You have very good inferential powers. So, that was a lot of work to get it, taking into account the bias and the variance covariance estimate that would arise from happening estimating from mean model parameters. That was the original derivation of the restricted maximum likelihood estimator that I just now showed for you guys. Again, it was originally called the residual maximum likelihood estimator, and the reason why is because really what we did with that U is we built the log likelihood for the residuals that came from the OLS model. So historically, that's where it came from. Sometime later, Laird and Ware kind of came through and said, look, you can also actually write that thing down and justify it by saying the restricted log or the restricted likelihood really is the same likelihood that you would get back if you took the original likelihood function that's a function of beta and alpha, the one that I had written on the board a second ago, and you integrated over a prior, so to speak, for the betas, the mean effects model, where you put a uniform prior distribution on those betas. In other words, if you will, a highly dispersed beta. Wisconsin doesn't let me say non-normative anymore, so highly dispersed beta, uniform beta prior on those guys. So that actually gives rise to the exact same likelihood that we just derived over. So it's kind of a fun, if you will, connection. And it shouldn't surprise you, right? The thing that I just written down, I called it a marginal likelihood. What I'm doing here is I'm marginalizing over the betas. I'm averaging over them. I'm putting equal weight on any possible beta, just averaging over them. Okay. Good. So there are a couple things about Rimmel, though, that you've got to be careful about. And people think it's kind of like the go-to thing all the time. One thing about Rimmel, realizing the way that the fact that we just spent all that work deriving it, you realize that it's based upon this likelihood for the data that's constructed from the residuals. Again, where beta hat is up there was the OLS residuals. That's how I got at that thing. So when you are comparing two different models that have different parameters in the mean model, you're comparing two different likelihoods for two different residuals. Okay? The beta hat is different in those two cases. And so what that means then is that Rimmel-based likelihood ratio tests should not be performed for elements of beta. Okay, they're not nested models anymore. They're likelihoods that are based upon residuals from two different means. Okay, so you shouldn't be doing likelihood ratio tests if you've used Rimmel to compare your model. Rimmel can be used to compare the covariances, and that's where we often do it. So if I want to test whether I need random slopes in my model plus random intercepts or just random intercepts, I can do that as long as I've kept the mean model the same, because again, the residuals there would be the same, okay, from the OLS model. So it's a consistent nested model in that case. So you can do likelihood ratio tests using Rimmel for the variance covariance components, in other words, the elements. Elements of alpha, but don't do it for beta. Okay? If you want to test for fixed effects components, then what you want to do is one of the following two things. If you want to test mean model components where you've done a mixed effects model and you've used Rimmel, then you better be using a walled test. Okay? That's fine. That's to make the variance covariance matrix a beta hat. Fine, formulate the walled statistic for testing, say, beta 2 in my case equal to 0. But if you want to fall back on a likelihood ratio test, then you better be doing that with just usual maximum likelihood estimation. The Rimmel estimation is not consistent in that case. Okay? The likelihoods are derived from two different models. All right. I say that, and I've said it four times now, and people will still continue to do it. And if you read the literature, people will do it. But it's not a valid test, it's not a consistent test in any way, shape, or form. Okay. Alright. Good. So, how about inference for the variance components then? We've been touching upon this already. That was kind of part of the rationale why I gave you the Arseny problem. And the Arseny problem was to look at the performance of a likelihood ratio test for testing the over-dispersion parameter inside of the negative binomial model. And if you remember, I said, really, likelihood theory does not hold there. And likelihood theory doesn't hold there because it's a test on the boundary. You were testing for that over-dispersion parameter equaling 0, and it can't really physically be 0. That's the boundary of its support. Okay? So you didn't have usual likelihood theory working, and in fact, on your guys' homework, you guys simulated that up, you saw that a level 0.05 test had about 1% type 1 error rate, and when you looked at its empirical distribution relative to a chi-square, you saw that, you know, normally what you'd like to see is the tops of these histograms sitting right along that. That's what theory would tell you. That's what likelihood-based theory would tell you if it held. Okay? The problem is it's something like a mixture. It's conservative here, and we talked about it being basically it's It's effectively a mixture between a point mass at zero and then a chi-square one, which is what the solid line that I have sitting there is. So that same principle holds when trying to test variance components. So now, if you think about a problem that we will often encounter, okay, which is you're trying to decide between a mixed effects model that has both a random intercept and a random slope, versus a model that only has a random intercept in it, what you're looking to test is the null hypothesis that D, remember that's the same notation I've been using, D is the variance covariance matrix of the random effect vector. Whether that thing breaks down into something that looks like a D11, so this would be the variance for the random intercept, but then zero for the variance of the random slopes. In other words, the population, individuals drawn from the population, don't have truly varying randoms or truly varying slopes. Versus the alternative that says, oh no, there's this variance there, and then most likely there is a variance covariance between the intercept and the slope. So you might start by saying, well, okay, looks like a nested model to me. I can get this by setting parameters equal to zero, so I'll go ahead and use the good old likelihood ratio test. So I'll formulate my likelihood ratio test statistic sitting down here under the full and reduced model. But the problem is that D22 again is on the boundary. Right? You're testing whether that variance component is equal to zero. It's the exact analogy of what we had for the alpha before. It's just slightly trickier in this case. Because what happens as D22 starts shrinking to zero? Don't tell the custodian this. I'm actually more upset about my comment. I didn't say that either. Erase that part.
Got it.
What happens as D22 gets pushed down to zero? What's the covariance between a random variable and a constant? Thank you. All right. D12 is going to get pushed to zero as well, right? So as D22 goes down to zero, D12 is going to be pushing down towards zero as well. Okay, so are you testing one parameter? Are you testing two parameters? Are you testing three parameters? The easy answer is you're definitely not testing three because you know D12 is equal to D21. Okay, so that one's easy. The question now is, are you testing one or two parameters? And the answer is you're testing somewhere in between one and two parameters. It's basically what it breaks down to. So just like before with alpha, we had a mixture between a point mass at zero and a chi-square with 1 degree of freedom. This test is going to fall somewhere between a mixture, or it's going to fall somewhere between a chi-square one and a chi-square two. And it's going to be a mixture. And there isn't really exact theory on this. Strand and Lee have a very nice paper. I would encourage you guys to read the Strand and Lee paper. They write down and say, look, it's going off to something in between these two, and it is a mixture of those distributions. But if you want to really determine what the mixture is, you really kind of need to simulate the reference distribution, similar to what I have you guys do for the negative binomial model. Okay. Luckily for you guys, it's kind of built into NLME, so I'll show you how to do that. Okay. So let's go through. Fit a few models inside of R, and I'll show you how to test for variance components as well. So I'm going to go back to the max data that we've been considering. This is the same data set that I was looking at where we kind of went through our EDA for the variance covariance, and then we fit an exchangeable and an AR1 process using a GEE model. So I'm just revisiting that same example. Now I'm going to approach it from a parametric perspective, meaning that we're going to fit a mixed effects model. So all the work that I've done here, I have done in the past. So this was just some of our descriptive statistics. And let's walk through. If you remember, the primary question there was to say, look, does the trajectory of viral load, truly log viral load, we log transformed it, the trajectory of CD4 differ depending upon the baseline log viral load values, right? That was what this scientific question was that we were interested in. Okay. So that mean model then broke down to saying, well, what we want is a main effect for time, log baseline viral load, and then the interaction here was really getting at that particular question, saying is there differential slopes between individuals depending upon their log baseline viral load values. Okay, so let's fit a few models there. If you remember some of the EDA that we had from last time, so what would be the analogy to what I'm doing, but in the GEE perspective, which is the random intercept model for a mixed effects model? It has a direct analogy in the GEE perspective. What type of variance covariance structure does the random intercept only model induce? Symmetric, compound symmetric, right? Exchangeable or compound symmetric. We use those two words interchangeably. So we fit that model in a GEE. Right, I had an exchangeable covariance matrix model that was fit there. The difference now is that I'm doing full likelihood-based inference, though, on the regression parameter components. There, I just did moment-based estimation based upon the residuals after each iteration. Okay, it's key for you guys to understand the difference here. The two models are effectively assuming the same things about the variance covariance matrix, but the way we're coming up with the estimates is different. Okay. All right. So, I've loaded in the NLME package, so just to run you briefly through what's going on here, this is your first specification actually of a mixed effects model. So the first thing is just the formula statement, which you would always have. That's, again, the systematic component, what we're trying to scientifically answer. You will see that there is an option called method. For right now, I'm going to just use maximum likelihood. In a second, I'm going to use restricted maximum likelihood. The reason both options exist are for people that want to likelihood ratio test on the systematic component parameters, betas, okay? Then next, you have a term or an option called random. Random is going to define the random effect structure, okay, that's inside of the model. And you can see here that what I'm doing is with this tilde 1 is I'm simply saying the only random effect I want in the model is the intercept. And how does the intercept defined in terms of clustering? It's defined by the ID of the subject. In other words, each individual ID has their own intercept. PD class, this is actually the default, but I'll put it here to show you guys right now. PD class is the form of the variance covariance matrix for the random effect. So PD symmetric just simply means that you want a positive definite symmetric variance covariance matrix. That's the only restrictions that are put on that. If you look, actually I'll go through it a little bit later, I'll go through a little bit more into this. You'd say, well, what other restrictions might I want on it? So one possibility is you could do PD diag, in other words, what I want is a positive definite and diagonal variance covariance matrix. If I did that, what am I assuming? I'm assuming that, for example, if I've got random intercepts and random slopes in the model, that they are independent from one another. I'm forcing that into the model. Okay, it's another restriction I'm putting down on the model. Generally speaking, you don't want to do those types of things. Okay, we've talked about the reasons why you have correlation between your random intercept and your random slope. So for the most part, you're safest going with like just PD sim. In other words, don't put any restrictions on it other than making it a valid variance covariance matrix, which means it has to be symmetric and positive definite. Yes.
Is this referring only to the random effect?
Only for the random effect, so it's that little b vector that I've got there. So really what I'm doing with that PD class, I'm defining capital D, right? I'm saying capital D just needs to be positive definite symmetric. Now in this particular case, it really doesn't matter, right? Because capital B is a scalar. Okay? But in general, as that thing becomes a vector, that's going to become a variance covariance matrix. Okay, and then finally, data equal max. So let's go ahead and have a fit here and then talk about some of the... some of the output. So a couple of things that you're going to get back. Oh, we're back to our good old friends here. Now you're coming back to AIC, BIC, and the log likelihood value. If you go back to that GEE fitting, none of those things were there because you were not doing maximum likelihood estimation. There is no definition of AIC anymore. There is no definition of BIC anymore. And the log likelihood, well, you didn't specify, but you specified an estimating equation. Okay. The next thing you come through, for the random effects, the only thing that's being estimated here is the intercept. So this is the standard deviation of that guy. So this thing is the square root of capital B11 in my notation. You're writing down notes on that, precisely what that is. The residual is the residual variance. And what are we assuming about the residual variance? So conditional upon the random intercept. I told you guys the default in mixed effects models is just to assume that the remaining residuals are IID. So they have a variance covariance matrix like sigma squared times the identity matrix. If you go back into my notes. Okay. So that residual standard error there, this would be sigma, little sigma in my notation. Going back to class. Okay. Now, two parts here. The first is the fixed effects for that model. So those are the betas. So these things in theory are comparable. They are in fact comparable, not in theory, but they are comparable to what we had in the GEE case. So what I would recommend for you guys is to take this, compare it back to the exchangeable variance covariance matrix for the GEE case that we did fit. Okay. You will see that it's fairly similar inference all the way across the board. Now notice here though, you get something called, you see the estimate, you see the standard error of the estimate, the degrees of freedom that are associated with that guy, the t-value and the p-value. What do you not have? Thinking about the GEE model. It doesn't say something like naive standard error, robust standard error, naive P, robust P, okay? The reason why? Because if you were thinking about this model and specification, you would have fit the GEE model to begin with. This is full likelihood-based inference. Here is your inference based upon the likelihood, okay? That's the underlying principle. Okay, notice one thing here. You see these things like month, degrees of freedom, 1242, and then you see log, baseline, viral load, degrees of freedom, 211. What's going on there? What type of variable is log, baseline, viral load?
Number of groups.
And so we have technical names for that. And that is a cluster-specific or time-invariant covariance. Okay? In other words, there is only one observation. That's the cross-sectional effect, basically, of what baseline viral load is. So you have 211 observations, well, slightly more than 211, minus the number of parameters that you're estimating in the model. So that's why that's 211. Month, on the other hand, what type of variable is that? Time variance. So now you have repeated measures on subjects, so the degrees of freedom for that are your total number of observations in the data set minus the parameters that are being estimated. So that's why you get this difference in the degree of freedom. So now, as I go down and I think about the correlation here, this is nothing more than the correlation between the fixed effects parameter estimates, okay, that you have up top. So we're not dealing with the random effects. Okay, very good. So now, again, comparing back to our inference from what we had before, very similar inference to what we had in the GE model, but you don't have the luxury of having the robust variance estimator back there. So you're kind of going up on the assumption of just a simple random effect, independent residual error. So I could go and I could say, okay, well, I realize that there is, let me go back up to this summary real fast. I realize that there is bias in the estimates of those variance components that are sitting there. So if I wanted to correct for that bias, refit that model, but now I'm going to fit it with RMLR, restricted maximum likelihood. So when I do that, you will notice that those point estimates change slightly. They are accounting for the fact that we estimated these fixed effects mean models. The inference overall, though, is not that different. These point estimates that are sitting here, same as those point estimates that are sitting up there. Okay. The standard errors are going to be slightly different, though, because of the change in how we estimated the variance components. Okay. They've used that marginal likelihood that we just derived. Okay. So now, we did see, though, that there was, in fact, a serial process to some degree. And the spaghetti plots are kind of hard to tell whether there's really random slopes or not, but we might want to entertain a random intercept and a random slope model, and then perhaps do inference on that. So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to change my model just slightly to include not only a random intercept sitting out here, but also a random slope. Okay, so I'm going to put a random effect on time for individuals as well. I'll do that again just right now with maximum likelihood. We could do a similar procedure with restricted maximum likelihood as well, though. So now if I fit that guy, see, point estimates are going to change slightly. That's because you changed the weight that's coming in for the variance covariance. But the other big thing that you have up here now is that you have square root of D11, square root of D22. In the notation that I've used before, that would be the square root of the variance or the random slope in the population. And then finally, that's the estimated correlation between the random intercept and the random slope. In other words, people that start off high tend to have a bigger decrease going down, which is kind of what you would expect when we talked about last time. It's a bit of a regression to the mean concept going on. Okay. Good. You'll see the inference overall doesn't really change that much in these guys. And part of that comes from, it's the same principles that we've been talking about, right? The reason that you're doing the A, BDA on the variance covariance is really the efficiency you're drawing back at the end of the day. Here it matters a lot more, though, in the sense that I don't have the robust variance estimator to kind of rely upon at the end of the day. Okay? So the inference I'm making here, I'm just really conditioning upon a model that truly has the A random intercept random slope. Independent residual error. Okay, so going back to that independent residual error, let me just jump to my notes really fast just to make sure that we're all on the same page. So this is still lecture 9, and right at the beginning, let me find it. We want to think a little bit about now, what is the residual error correlation structure? So that capital R, I've been focusing on capital D right now. Okay. So in other words, the random effects that are inside of that model. But what about capital R? And as I said, a very common assumption, and that's what we've just now fit, is that that capital R, the variance for those residuals, just looks like sigma squared times an identity. In other words, once I've conditioned upon the random effect for the subject in this case, I've just got independent errors. Depend upon time. But we also said that, well, look, you might be thinking about the fact that maybe there's correlation in those errors still depending upon the random effect. In other words, you haven't accounted for everything that makes the subject unique to themselves. And it could be that measurements closer in time are still more correlated, or I should say errors closer in time are still more correlated than errors farther apart in time. And so we talked about an AR process as follows. So let's go ahead and fit that model. So the way that you can specify that model now is not only do you say, okay, look, I want a random effect in my model. In this case, I'm just doing a random intercept. But I also want some sort of correlation process on the remaining residuals. And I'm going to let you guys look into the help, and I'll talk a little bit more about it probably Tuesday, maybe Monday of next week, on the possible options here. But by far the most popular in, say, longitudinal or spatial data is like an AR process, okay? So in other words, assuming that you got this exponentially decaying. So that's that correlation AR1 structure. And the form is, again, just looking at some constant that's like sigma squared is decaying with inside of the ID and going down. So in other words, you're not having that correlation process depending upon a cohort. So this is now a random intercept model plus an AR01 structure. And again, fairly similar inference all the way across the board on the main effects, but what you see now is you've got root D11, you've got the residual error term that's sitting up here, this 175. That's going to be the square root of sigma back on my notes. If I go back there, that's this guy here, this little sigma. And then that phi is giving an estimate of what the autoregressive parameter is that's sitting there. So that parameter estimate phi that's sitting down there is now estimating that autoregressive structure as I go along in time. Okay. Everybody with me on this so far? So this is really this implementation of every one of the models that we've gone through. How is the estimation working? It's just maximum likelihood. It's Newton-Raphson basically on that log by This is truly using the profile likelihood because it's done by maximum likelihood. It's not restricted. Okay.
Dan.
Yes.
The correlation defaults to compound symmetric?
The correlation.
So where you put in correlation equals the AR1.
Yes.
Defaults to compound symmetric?
No, that for AR1 means correlation is autoregressive 1. So there is no defaulting to, oh, you're talking about over, like, if I were to have a PD class, for example?
Well, in the above lines, you don't put the correlation line at all, right? In your above models, right?
There's no correlation.
So you're specifying correlation.
Oh, yes, so I'm sorry. So if that's not there, I'm sorry. Yes, sorry, Godfrey. I was trying to interpret your question slightly differently. Yeah, so if correlation is not there, the assumption is that you've just got independence on the residual errors. In other words, they look like sigma squared times the identity.
Okay.
Okay, as you go through. Okay. And let's see. I might get in trouble doing this because it's been a little while since I went through this out loud, but why not? Let's see. So you can see that the core classes that are going to be there, it'll say, okay, for AR1, again, that's the most common, but you could put ARMA models on there, or you could put continuous autoregressive processes on there as you're going through. But what it will default to is, let's see here, it should say back over here, actually. Yeah, it defaults to no, corresponding to no with number of correlations. So again, I would spend a little bit of time going through the help files. I don't want to spend all of class kind of going through everything. I'm going to highlight certain other aspects of this and fit a couple of different correlation models in the future as we go through. But it would really literally take us to six weeks. It's going to be helpful as well. So I want to do that. Okay. So now, there's another way to fit that model, and I'm going to bring it up for a particular reason. So this would be a continuous AR process now. So what I had before, where I have form is tilde 1, that would just assume that any two measurements were just equally spaced going apart, right? That's what really an AR1 process is. But we know that people were measured at different points in time. So what I would really like to have, again, just going back to lecture 9, is a continuous autoregressive process. It doesn't just count J minus K like this. This is what we just now fit. But really takes into account the distance in time between any of those two measurements. You guys with me on that? Okay. Because they're going to be variable across individuals. So now, if I want to fit that continuous AR process, what I can do is I can say, okay, remember I referred to it at one point as an exponential decay correlation process because you can write it in back and reverse in terms of an exponential. Go back to my notes on lecture 3, don't recall that. So now, yeah, friendly.
So does it just round the nearest discrete
this now? This guy?
Yeah, for the exponential decay.
That literally takes in month at whatever month it was, so it could be a decimal to be truly continuous in time. And what you're fitting, again, is a correlation structure on the residuals that looks like this, right? There's some absolute value of the distance between any two measurements in time. Okay? Or month is my measurement now. Okay? Again, the previous model that we just now had, that I just fit, the AR1, assumed this. It said, look, I've got measurement one, and then I've got measurement two, the distance between those things is one. I don't care if it was taken a month apart or a year apart. I'm going to call it one. You guys with me? That would be appropriate if you had something fixed by design, where everybody was coming back at the exact same time, for example. It's not really the case here. So now, if I want to fit that continuous autoregressive process, again, I can do it with what's referred to as an exponential correlation decay model. It's the same model that we had there. And again, if you go back to my notes, I tell you why that is true. And so the form now is going to be as a function of month that's sitting here. And it's going to be, again, clustered with inside of ID. This is the residual with inside of ID. And I have this little thing over here right now. It would default to nugget being false, but I just kind of want to highlight it. That nugget is going to come back in just a second for us. Okay, and I'll tell you guys what it is in just one moment. So now, this is accounting for the fact that I have differential measurements in time. You see, you get this thing called a range parameter that's up there. So let's go to my notes really quickly. Talk about what that is. So the range parameter, so truly the nugget that I just set equal to false, which means don't estimate it, is 1 minus the correlation between two observations that are taken arbitrarily close in time. So what are they getting at with the nugget term? They're getting back to that measurement error. Remember that residual measurement error as I start shrinking in on time? And I talked about kind of that Diggle model where you have a random intercept, a serial process, and then some residual error. That's what that nugget is representing. So when I put nugget equals false, which is what it defaults to, it means that you are assuming that the model has no additional measurement error in it. In other words, as you come arbitrarily close in time on two observations, that correlation between those observations goes to one. Well, if that's true, then what that means is the nugget would go to 1 in that case. Or sorry, would go to 0 in that case. And so the range then just looks like that good old exponential correlation decay structure that I've got there. So the range is e to the minus 1 over range, where you have this thing. It's really between two observations taken 1 unit apart. Oops, sorry. Sorry about that.
Sorry, ranges.
Did it again. Oh, I'm going back to it. Hold on 1 second. So the range is actually this parameter that's sitting inside here. So to make the range meaningful, you've got to do a bit of a transformation on it. I'm going to show you it in just a second, okay? So in our case, the nugget is going to be taken to 0. Okay, because I said nugget equals to false in the model I just now fit, assuming no measurement there. So this thing goes to 1. And so now, if I want to think about a correlation between two observations that are taking 1 month apart in this case, right, because I'm measuring time in months, so it's 1 unit apart, it's 1 month, it's going to be e to the minus 1 over the range. That's going to be the correlation. Okay? Yes?
What is it called nugget? So
Yeah, I know, it's an odd term. So really where this terminology came from was not longitudinal data, but it was back in the days of spatial data. And so the nugget was kind of thinking about you have this residual nugget that gets left over as you're kind of shrinking space, the distance between any two measurements back down to 0. So you have to blame Peter Diggle for it, I think, is the underlying premise here. Okay. But that is what we call it. So,
why do we bother with range when we could just specify a row?
It's because of the way the model gets parameters. So first of all, this is a very popular parameterization in spatial statistics. That's first of all, I will tell you that. kind of that exponential correlation decay, or exactly how people started writing it down. So I tend to agree with you, Ina, and that's exactly why I presented it as just rho, and I have a slide that says it transforms back into e to the minus 1 over. But historically, this is kind of the parameterization that people use, and partly for the estimation on things. Okay, so you want to keep this thing having full range. But I tend to think about, and you'll see what I'm going to do right now. So that range parameter, to make it interpretable for us from what we've been talking about, would really be e to the minus 5. So if I do that, you see that my rho is now 0.822. Okay, so what that is that's the correlation, the estimated correlation on two residuals that are taken 1 month apart after conditioning upon the random effects. You guys with me? So now, going back to Ina's question here, one of the things that I could do is I could fit that exact same model. I'm showing you the core EXP in a minute because I want you to be able to account for the negative. But I could have fit it with core continuous autoregressive. Okay, so now I have added a C in here, and I put that it's determined by the month. And if we look at that guy, so Ina, do you like that better? That'll come back right with row, okay? So that phi now represents, again, the correlation that I just now estimated with the range. The problem with it, and the reason why I'm showing you the other one first, is because the core AR1 that I just now fit, so this particular version of it will not allow me to now have that negative term inside of there, so it won't allow me to now account for residual and measurement error on top of it. So I tend to go with the core ESP form of this. But those two models are in fact exactly equivalent. If you look at everything that's up here, they are the same in terms of standard error estimates and rules. It's just a different way of calling the same model a continuous AR1 process. This one is a little bit nicer, right, Nina, because it gives me back something that I can at least interpret right off the bat and say, okay, the residual correlation between two observations or two errors taken 1 month apart is about 0.822. The other one I have to do a little bit more work for. But the other one allows me to incorporate measurement error. And if you go back again to the diagnostics that we had from last time, oops, for these data, I'm jumping back into, again, this is our lecture 8, we saw that there was fairly significant measurement error that's there, right? That's what this vertical line right here is. Okay, if that thing was going down to 0, fine. Nugget equal false is fine, except the nugget equal down to 0. But that's not really what we're talking about. So I'd like to be able to account for this in the variance covariance structure. And remember, the decisions that I'm making now that I'm in this mixed effects setting really matter. I don't have a safety net anymore. You know what I'm referring to as the safety net? The robust variance estimator, right? I don't have that anymore. You guys with me? So what I'm basing my variance estimates on for my scientific question, when I look at this summary up here and I take these standard errors, those are definitely influenced quite heavily by the assumptions that I'm making on that variance covariance structure that's sitting there.
So in practice, we just use GE?
No, I would argue that in practice, 90% of the time people use mixed effects models.
No, but you yourself.
Yes. Yes. It depends upon what my goal is. Let me reframe for just a second when I say that in practice. Because I do use mixed effects models, and I do use them quite a lot. But it depends upon what my scientific goal is. If my goal really here was to test that fixed effect, and that's what I care about, which is what it is in this particular problem, based on something in the GE model. So I can draw a reference on that. If my goal was really to characterize the variation in the slopes of CD4s across the population, I don't have it up here actually, it's fit one. then I'd be fitting a random intercept random slope on, and I would be characterizing that with D22. You guys with me? So that was my goal. I'm not getting that out of the GEE model. There's no way, no shape, no form. So I would need to be doing something more parametric to be able to estimate those things. If my goal were individual level prediction, what would be my prediction estimates from a GEE model?
Just
the marginal mean on the population conditional on the covariates. What I'm going to show you in just a second is we can estimate the individual random intercept or random slope for people. So it'll allow you to tailor, if you will, the prediction to some degree around that individual. So if I were looking to do prediction, I'd be going with the mixed effects model. Okay. So when I say yes, and I kind of instantly said yes, that's because oftentimes, 9 times out of 10 in my work, I'm interested in those things. So that will be for you. All right. Good. So now, if I want to allow for that random measurement error to come in, I can just simply modify the exponential correlation structure on the residuals, but then bring forward that equal true. Okay. And so, to take you guys back to a model that you have seen written down, this is exactly the model that we derived that we had derived the variogram off of. And so it's that thing that I refer to as the Diggle model. Okay? So what I have in the model that I'm getting ready to fit right now is a random intercept for each person, an autoregressive, a continuous autoregressive serial process, that's what I'm putting on W, and then measurement error on the epsilon I case. So it is exactly that model. So now, to fit that, now you see that 0.21583, remember, that's 1 minus the correlation between two observations taken arbitrarily closely apart in time. Again, if you're assuming that that thing is 0, you're assuming that that correlation goes to 1. What this is telling you is, no, there's about a 0.8 correlation, right, as you shrink it in time. That's the fact that that variogram is not going down to 0. I mean, that's what you're seeing there. Okay. Good. So now you have to do a little bit more work, you know, to translate this back to the correlation, going back to Ina and Arnie's question just a few minutes ago, to translate it back into the correlation between observations, you would do it like so. Yeah, if I can find it. Sorry, I know I'm jumping around a little bit on you guys, but you do it like so. Right? If you want to minus that, not yet, you know, minus e to the minus one of the range. Good. Everybody with me so far? Yeah, all right. So now, we might want to compare some of the models, right? And so, for example, FIT0 was just a random intercept only model. FIT1 had a random intercept and a random slope inside of it, okay? So you might think, okay, well, I'll do the LRT. So if I do that, it will definitely give you back the likelihood ratio test statistic comparing a random intercept alone versus the random intercept and random slope model. Notice what it does here. Degrees of freedom 6 to 8. It's counting D12 and D22 as both parameters in that test, okay, as you're going through. And you're rejecting HO, and what is that telling you truly? That there's definitely some random slope in addition to the random intercept that's going on, by the way, right? And it turns out that basing this upon 2 degrees of freedom, which is what it's doing, it's basing everything here on a chi-square with 2 degrees of freedom, that's a conservative test, because really the true reference distribution is somewhere between 1 and 2 degrees of freedom. So I'll come back in just a second to testing between, for example, the nugget effect. But let's investigate right now the reference distribution for testing the random intercept and random slope. Just like you guys saw in homework, again, that asymptotic theory breaks down. So if you really wanted to get it estimating the random intercept, random slope LRT test statistic reference distribution. One way to do that is to simulate it. That's pretty much what I had you guys do for the negative binomial in class, right? You simulated up that reference distribution, okay? So, lucky for you guys, inside of the NLME package, there's actually a function called simulate.lme, okay? And it will do that for you. It'll kind of look at what the appropriate mixture of chi-squares should be for that reference distribution. So I'm gonna hit this, but it usually takes a few minutes to run. It's doing some resampling. We'll see how long it takes. Oh, by the way, I got so frustrated on Sunday, I went by my computer. So let's see if this thing.
Whoa.
This is how I punish Apple, right? It's like, you sell me a laptop that I hate, so what I'll do, I'll go buy another Mac. Because I just couldn't take it. Oh yeah, that's pretty fast though, I gotta say. Okay, so it was fairly quick. All right. But if this one doesn't work on every projector that I ever put it on, then that's... Okay. There is that. You know what? So I just did it, but you guys have a... So what this is doing is it's showing you the simulated reference distribution for the p-values, the empirical p-value and the nominal p-value that you would have if you used a chi-square with 1 degree of freedom. In other words, assume you're testing one parameter, just D22. What ANOVA just gave you where you're testing two parameters, D22 and D12, so taking a chi-square 2. And then what I have put inside here is a mixture between 1 and 2 chi-squared, okay? And so what you would like to have is that the empirical p-value, in other words, that's the empirical type 1 error, is equal to the nominal p-value. That's what you wanted it to be, right, as you're running up. And really, what level tests are we doing here generally, oftentimes? You guys are looking at those p-values. Alpha, like 0.05 oftentimes, kind of industry standard. So you're really kind of looking down in this quadrant down here, right? So small values of that nominal test. Most of us aren't doing level 0.87 tests. I hope not, anyways. So what you can see is if you use a chi-square 1 distribution, your true type 1 error rate is actually, your empirical p-value, which equates to your true type 1 error rate, is going to be larger than what your nominal type 1 error rate is. In other words, it's going to be anti-conservative, right? You haven't taken into account these things. If you use a chi-square 2, you're going to be conservative. This is what you guys saw back on the homework simulation. And if you're kind of somewhere in the middle here, or a mixture of the two, and this is taking a 1/2, so it's like a chi-square 1/2, if you think about that, you're still a little bit conservative, but you're kind of coming down, okay? Now you can do a little bit of exploratory work, and you can actually put in the degrees of freedom that you want. And so I've already gone through and done this example. So what I'll do is just for a 1.3 mixture. It's not really 1.5. What if you read textbooks, they would just say use a 1.5. Just do it. It depends upon the correlation structure in the data. True. And so if you take a chi-square 1.3, this line is about now at y equal x. I mean, so I'm just kind of ranging those weights in there through the simulation. Okay. So that would be the appropriate test of random effects with using a mixture of chi-squares where, again, there's really no underlying theory, but what we can do is simulate up the reference distribution and get something approximately correct back at the end of the day. Okay. Everybody okay with that? Yeah.
So if you were actually doing this in order to do the test, would you do these simulations to be able to get the
position? Exactly. That's what I would do, Olivia. What most people do, and you know, again, yes, yeah, guess but what most people do is that they'll just go into ANOVA. I mean, they'll type ANOVA, they'll go back to 2, where's my p-value? now you guys know better, so you guys have to do the extra work to make sure that I'm getting the correct references for you. Okay. So now, so that was our quick little summary there. So now you might say, now I'm just going to extend this just a tad bit more. And suppose that, you know, we've assumed, if you will, this linear trajectory of CD4 accounts across time for subjects. I just have a main effect per month. This is really just for illustrative purposes. Suppose you wanted to investigate whether you also needed a quadratic term for CD4. In other words, maybe it's kind of coming down quickly and then stabilizing off, for example, as you're going through time. So now let's do a little bit of inference on the systematic, that's part of the systematic component, right, for this model. So I'm asking whether I need a squared term for time to come into the model. So now let's do a little bit of inference there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to define a new model. Again, our empirical variogram basically pointed to this model. It had random intercepts, it had a serial process, it had measurement errors. That's why I'm kind of focusing here. And all of our EEA basically pointed to something that looked like this. So that is that model at the end of the day. So now I'm going to go ahead and fit this guy. I'll call it fit 4, but what I have changed now is the systematic component. Okay, so now I've put in a squared or a quadratic term from 1. That's time in our case, as well as putting that out in for the interaction. So what I'm asking is the trajectory, the quadratic trajectory, changing depending upon log of the signed viral status. Okay. When I do that, just as before, I can go through now and I can do an ANOVA where I'm taking FIT3, that's the same variance covariance structure, same random effects and correlation structure that I had for FIT3, but what I have there is this term is gone and this term is gone, okay? So I'm just fitting linear trajectories over time. So I can go through and I can do an ANOVA test. Why do I feel comfortable trusting this LRT now? Because it's fixed effects and because I've done the estimation via maximum likelihood, not restricted maximum likelihood, okay? You guys with me on this? If I wanted to do this test and I've done all my estimation under restricted maximum likelihood, what test should I be using? A wall. A multivariate wall, right, for those two parameters. You guys with me on this? Okay. But I've done the estimation via maximum likelihood, so when I build those likelihoods, they're on the same residuals from the same correlation structure, right, for those variance components. Okay. So now, what's the interpretation of that test? I don't really need the quadratic terms, right? I mean, so I was doing it, I was telling you guys I'm doing it for pedagogical reasons, like a linear trend. You saw that basically from the spaghetti plots. It's fairly linear, kind of going down. Okay, so that's fitting exactly what you would be expecting there. Okay, so I think we've just about killed this guy. So the conclusions there would be, so your HO would be that those two parameters corresponding to the quadratic main effect and then the quadratic interaction term for time would be equal to 0. The alternative is at least one of them is different from 0, and you fail to reject HOs. Okay, so we're going to leave this guy here. Tomorrow, I will take questions for the midterm, if you guys would like. And if not, I will continue on with estimating those random effects, subject-specific random effects for predictions. Okay. I've got homework 2 up here. I don't normally have to say this to any class, but be here on time tomorrow.